Hello, class 8. Welcome to your history class. Till now, we had read about how the Rajputs, how the Sikh, the different states like Mysore, Hyderabad, Bengal, how they established themselves as an independent state, right? Now in today's class, we'll read about how the Marathas came into existence and how they established themselves as an independent authority, right? So let's study about it. The Marathas. The Marathas had long lived in the region around Satara. So Satara, that means around it's a western part of Deccan Plateau. So Deccan Plateau, it's South India, Southern India. So they were courageous. Marathas were courageous and fearless warrior, right? Okay, in the 17th century, the Marathas found a new leader in the form of a very famous name, prominent name, that is Shivaji. Right? Shivaji, the son of General Sahaji Bhosle, who had been active in Ahmednagar between 1633 to 1636. Leading the battle against the Mughals. From around 1658, Shivaji was able to free the Marathas from the Muslim sultans of Bijapur to the southeast and carve out an independent Maratha zone. Zone means area around Pune, incorporating the Bijapur and Golconda sultanates and some Mughal areas. So by 1658, Shivaji was able to make the Marathas free from Mughal, free from the control of Mughals, right? Now, after a lifetime of exploits and guerrilla warfare, very important, just underline this guerrilla warfare. Underline this word, guerrilla warfare against the Mughal Emperor Aurangzeb. Shivaji died in 1680, leaving a Maratha kingdom of great extent but strategically and vulnerably located. Okay, we all know about Shivaji, that he was well known for his tactics, and he was very courageous and fearless warrior. As well as he had extensive knowledge about his area, right? So about his area means he knew every mountain, hillocks, every hills of his area, right? And he was known for this guerrilla warfare also. So what is guerrilla warfare? It's a tactics, or guerrilla warfare means it's a tactics like a tactics to attack someone's place or someone's territory suddenly. So we can say sudden attack without informing, or sudden raids we can say. So that's a guerrilla warfare, and he was well known for Shivaji was well known for guerrilla warfare. So we can write here guerrilla means sudden attack, right? Sudden attack or sudden raids. So he believed in sudden raids, sudden attack, and he believed in when he attacked, he looted and escaped that place, right? So that was his tactics. And because of that guerrilla warfare and against that Mughal emperor Aurangzeb, he was succeeded also. He was successful also, right? So, but in 1680, Shivaji was died, leaving a Maratha kingdom a great extent. Great extent means a large, leaving that kingdom a large territory, large area, large land. But strategically and vulnerably located. Vulnerably located means it is at the center of the enemies, right? So it is at the center, which is surrounded by enemies from all the sides. Now, After Shivaji's death, effective power in the Maratha state was wielded by a family of Chitpavan Brahmanas who served Shivaji's successor as Peshwa, all principal minister. Pune became the capital of the Maratha kingdom. Under the Peshwa, the Maratha developed a very successful military organization comprising of cavalry, infantry and artillery. So here are the three new words we have got. One is infantry, second is artillery, then we have third one is And the third one is cavalry. So let's write the meaning of this infantry. Infantry means the army or the soldiers who fight on foot. So the army, or the we can write a soldier. Fight on foot, that is infantry, right? Now artillery means it's a weapon that moved on wheel, or the weapons used for discharging firearms, right? So you can write that the weapons moved on wheel, or you can the diagram here from this you can get the idea what does this artillery mean. Firearm. Firearm, right? Now next, cavalry. So cavalry, earlier in past, this the soldiers or the army persons who fought on the horses, right? They used to move on the horse backs, and they fought on horses, right? So in past they were known as cavalry. Nowadays in modern army, this cavalry means soldiers. They were the soldiers who fought on horses, but in modern army they are the soldiers who used heavily protected vehicles, right? So in present they are the soldiers who used heavily protected vehicles. So that's the cavalry, right? Okay. Now their success lay in bypassing the fortified areas of the Mughals by raiding cities and by engaging Mughal armies in areas where their supply lines and reinforcement could be easily disturbed. So their success lay by bypassing means to go around that areas where the Mughals had fortified their armies and disturbing their army lines and disturbing their reinforcement, disturbing the Mughal armies and supply lines means disturbing the supply lines means disturbing the route from where the Mughal used to pass food or equipments to their soldiers, right? So disturbing those cities, those areas, armies, and those fortified areas of Mughals, the Marathas had consolidated their territory, as well as they were successful in expanding their Maratha Empire, right? So the Maratha Empire expanded rapidly between 720 to 1761 by chipping away important regions of the Mughal Empire, right? Malwa and Gujarat were seized from Mughals by the 1720s, and by the 1730s, the Maratha Empire expanded their territories up to the Deccan. So up to the whole of Deccan, we can say. Whole of Deccan means whole South India, right? And the Marathas used to levy taxes in the two forms, and that two forms are Chauth and Sardesh Mukhi. So the Marathas, they used to levy taxes. One was Chauth and the second was Sardesh Mukhi. So what is this Chauth? Chauth is 1/4 of the total production. Right? Whereas Sardesh Mukhi, that means 1/10 of the production, total production, that is Sardesh Mukhi, right? So these were the Marathas used to levy taxes, Chauth and Sardesh Mukhi in the entire region, entire territory. Chauth was 1/4 of the total produce, whereas Sardesh Mukhi was 1/10 of the total produce, as I told you, right? After raiding Delhi in 1737, the frontiers of Maratha dominations expanded rapidly. After raiding Delhi, after occupying Delhi, the Maratha dominations, right, expanded rapidly, quickly into Bengal and Odisha in the east. That means Bengal and Odisha also added to Maratha, and Rajasthan and Punjab in the north. That is, these states were also included in Marathas, and Karnataka and Tamil and Telugu countries. So Telugu countries means Tamil Nadu, right? So those Telugu countries in the south, they all were included in Maratha, right? But these were not directly included in the Maratha Empire. These were not included directly in the Maratha Empire, Maratha Kingdom, but were made to pay tribute as a way of accepting Maratha sovereignty, right? So directly they were not included in Maratha Empire, but these states or these territories, these kingdom had to pay tribute to Maratha, right? For accepting Maratha's sovereignty. Expansion brought enormous resources, but it came at a price. These military campaigns also made other rulers hostile towards the Marathas. That means hostiles towards Marathas means this like expansion policy made many enemies, right? Expansion policy made by Marathas, that policy made lot of enemies. And these military campaigns also made other rulers hostile towards the Marathas. As a result, they were not inclined to support the Marathas during the Third Battle of Panipat in 1761. Because of this reason, that because of expansion policy of Marathas, other surrounding territories, kingdoms, they did not support Marathas in the Third Battle of Panipat, which was fought in 1761. Alongside endless military campaigns, the Marathas developed an effective administrative system as well. Not only military campaigns, but they had consolidated one more department, that was administrative system as well. So they had consolidated, or they had developed an effective administrative system as well. Once conquest had been completed and Maratha rule was secure, revenue demands were gradually introduced, taking local conditions into account. Agriculture was encouraged and trade revived. So that means trade means export and import. So that was also revived, and this allowed Maratha chief sardars like Sindhia of Gwalior, Gaikwad of Barodra and Bhosle of Nagpur the resources to raise powerful armies. Children, we have completed the chapter. Now let's move to the exercises. So let's do exercise C. That is, match the contents of column A with the column B suitably. In A column, it's written number 1, Subedar, number 2, Fauzdar, 3rd is Misal, 4th is Chaut, 5th is Misal, and the 6th one is Mysore. In another column, B column, A, it's written a tax levied by the Marathas, B is Tipu Sultan, 3rd, C, that is Sikh, and D, a band of Sikh warriors, E, provincial governor, and F, a Mughal military commander. So now let's match these two columns. So answer 1, this is answer C 1, Subedar. So answer of C 1, Subedar, that is the provincial governor. So we are going to match with E. A with one with E, that is provincial governor. Now next, Fauzdar. We know Fauzdar, it's what? It's a military commander or a Mughal military commander. 2 with F, a Mughal military commander. Now next, number 3, Misal. So Misal, we know it's a band of Sikh warriors. 3rd, D, a band of Sikh warriors. 4th, Chaut. So we know Chaut is what? It's a tax levied by the Marathas. So 4th, A, a tax levied by the Marathas. Now number 5, that is Misal. So we can write here C, that is Sikh, right? And the 6th one, Mysore, and we know Mysore, 6th one, that is B, Tipu Sultan. That is the 6th one. 6th B, Mysore, Tipu Sultan. Right? So, just note down this. Now, let's move to the fill in the blanks. Fill in the blanks with the suitable word and words. Fill in the blanks. Question D, number 1. Dash invaded India in 1739. So the answer is Nadir Shah. Nadir Shah invaded India in 1739. Right? Okay, second, Burhan ul Mulk Sadat Khan was appointed Subedar of Dash in 1722. Answer is Awadh. Answer is Awadh. Right? Now number 3. Murshid Quli Khan was a ruler of Bengal. Write down Bengal. Don't get confused with this Chin Quilich Khan, because Chin Quilich Khan was the founder of Hyderabad state, who was also known as Nizam-ul-Mulk Sadat Asaf Jah. Nizam-ul-Mulk Asaf Jah. Chin Quilich Khan. He was the founder of Hyderabad state. But the question is Murshid Quli Khan, and Murshid Quli Khan was the ruler of Bengal. So do write Bengal here. Now next, Sawai Raja Jai Singh was the ruler of Amber. A-M-B-E-R. Amber. Now next, Haider Ali and Tipu Sultan were the rulers of Mysore. Note it down. Next, the Dash were known for guerrilla warfare. So who were known for guerrilla warfare? The Marathas. So M, do write capital. Marathas. The Marathas were known for guerrilla warfare. Right? If the question is like this, Dash was known for guerrilla warfare. So was means asking for one particular person. One person, right? So we would write what? Shivaji. Shivaji was known for guerrilla warfare. But the question is Dash were known for guerrilla warfare, right? So in place of Shivaji, here you'll write the Marathas. The Marathas were known for guerrilla warfare. Clear? Okay. Now let's move to question E. That is true and false. True and false. Whether the statement is true or false, you need to write in front of the statements. Now see question E1. Nader Shah invaded Bengal. The statement is false. Nader Shah invaded Delhi. Right? Okay. Second question. Sawai Raja Jai Singh was the ruler of Indore? No. Sawai Raja Jai Singh was the ruler of Amber. Third, Guru Gobind Singh was the first guru of the Sikh? False. The statement is false. Guru Nanak ji was the first guru of the Sikh. In place of Guru Gobind Singh, you will write Guru Nanak or Guru Nanak ji. Number 4, Pune became the capital of the Marathas in the 18th century. Yes, the statement is true. 5, Shivaji was the ruler of Mysore. No. In place of Shivaji, either you write Haider Ali or Tipu Sultan, right? Or in place of Mysore, you can write Shivaji was the ruler of Maratha kingdom. Clear? Okay. So only the question here, question E, state whether true or false is written, but you are going to correct the statement, correct the false statement, right? So now question C, D, E, that's your homework. So we have completed this chapter here, children. Okay, children, that's all for the day. Soon we'll meet in the next video. Till then, bye-bye.